So the idea is that I'll give you a very, very brief overview over why inequality matters, and just so we're kind of on the same level, that we do know that it does matter, and then talk you through seven myths related to inequality that my economist adheres to more, well, to varying degrees actually, but we'll see that. I'll tell you a little bit about the concept first, just so we understand that as well, and then hopefully we'll have some time for discussion. In spite of this setup, lengthy setup trouble. I wanted to start by giving you a quote from Brett DeLong, who talked about the state of neoclassical economics and its assumptions these days. And he says, "I think that modern neoclassical economics is in fine shape, as long as it is understood as individual, as the ideological and substantial legitimation doctrine of a political theory of possessive individualism. As long as we have relatively self-interested liberal individuals who have relatively strong beliefs that things are theirs, the competitive market in equilibrium is an absolutely wonderful mechanism for achieving truly extraordinary degree of societal coordination and productivity. We need to understand that, we need to value that, and that is what neoclassical economics does and does well." And then he goes on to give a number of caveats to the general belief. And these are lots, and we don't have to go through all of them. In fact, I think most of us are probably familiar with them and know what their limitations are. We all agree that there is a certain need to simplify for modeling. But I would like to focus on the number 9 of this, because it's very crucial to analyzing inequality. And it says that the distribution of wealth must correspond to societal consensus of need and desert. So it must correspond to our ideas of what we want to have as a just society and what we need to have in terms of inequality. Okay, so this course, as you all know, is entitled Neglects of Neoclassical Economics, somewhat ambitiously. So we want to start from this position, that this is the supposition of neoclassical economics towards inequality and what that means for inequality. Of course, nobody argues seriously that we want to have equal compensation for everybody, for everything. So it's a question of degree. But if we think about this need and desert or wish for income distribution structure of society and look at how this plays out, I think this is in the US, but it's kind of comparable in other countries. This graph shows three columns. One of them is the actual distribution of income, one is the ideal distribution of income that people feel it should be like, and the other one is the one they think it is. Which one do you think is which? Any ideas?
Say again, the three possibilities.
So one is the one we think is the real one, one is the one we would like to have as a real one, and the third is the actual.
So people think that it's the one very right.
People think it's this one.
Some people think that they had the judgment that had all the income.
You think it's on the right?
Yeah.
So
I think people think it's the middle, and they want it to be the left, and it's actually the right.
They want it to be the left.
Exactly.
I think it's the middle.
That's right. So this is the actual distribution, okay? This is what people think that they would like it to be, and this is what it really is. Okay, so there's a huge problem with perception of inequality, and this is really, really crucial to understand, because obviously for a long time we had this idea, well, inequality is necessary, and I'll go through that in a second, but that might be very largely related to the fact that we don't actually know what inequality is like in the world. We all think it's something which it is actually not. So I want to give you three very stylized facts about inequality, and that will be quite intuitive, and you'll remember that forever and the rest of your lives, probably, or at least one of them, after this lecture. Inequality is a lot greater than we think, and then more. Yeah, so we don't even know how big it is, really. Inequality is a problem that concerns everybody. It's not just the poor, it's not just the rich, it's everybody. And inequality can actually be ameliorated, the distribution can be improved with adequate policy measures, okay? So these three things, just keep them in the back of your head. We have heard lots of numbers about what inequality might be these days, and they vary a little bit depending on the concept that we use to measure inequality. Something like members of the top percentile of wealth holders now own almost 2,000 times that which the bottom 50% of the world population holds. These kind of numbers is very, very stark. Puts into question whether this is something that we really need, or at least do we need it at this level, inequality. There has been, as I said, a consensus that the current distribution of incomes is in accord with what we need and desire, our ninth commandment from neoclassical economics. And that is based on a number of assumptions or myths, and they justify this need. We just saw the desire is the one to the left. So obviously income distribution is not in line with that, so we'll focus now for the rest of the lecture a little bit more on the need of having inequality or not. So maybe everybody here has by now heard about this French guy that wrote a book on inequality in capitalism. There's a Dutch economist that says he must have been sitting in a cave if you haven't heard about Piketty by now. And I think with him and his book, maybe assumptions change a lot. So when I gave this talk last year, I could be a lot more polemic, and maybe now I cannot be as polemic about the assumptions, because I think they're in the change right now. But still, there are some uphold beliefs that I think we should address in continuation. Okay, so besides presenting some really, really good data, the book by Piketty, which I'm obviously talking about, has managed to raise a lot of attention, especially among mainstream economists, and I say among mainstream economists because many other people have actually looked at inequality before. So it's not like a completely new field, but it's quite new to show a concern from the mainstream perspective. So before looking at the concrete assumptions, we can just have a brief look. Okay, this graph is only until 2000, but you can imagine for the next decade continues, you can look up the numbers for yourself. We can see that inequality is increasing, okay? This is a very important fact. But there is another very important fact, a bit stylized as well. Looks a bit complicated, but it basically just shows that inequality is very diverse. Yeah, both across countries and within countries. This graph is by Sutcliffe, and he shows that if we have income on the y-axis and we have countries lined up according to their wealth on the x-axis, and on the z-axis we have classes within the country, so that's income distribution within any given country, you can see that in poor countries, inequality is fairly low. Yeah, in rich countries or medium income countries, it's very high. That's very important. And you can see that on Milander's graph here, where he shows that if we had the world population according to income, so this is the richest individuals in the world, and this is the poorest individuals in the world, compared to what happens within every country, you see that the poorest people in the US, they're roughly at the 60th percentile, of the world distribution, okay? So they're fairly rich in global terms, and obviously the richest individuals are. Well, very, very true. If we then look at India or China, their poorest people are very, very, very poor, and their rich people reach roughly the level of poor people in the US. And then we have countries like Brazil. Okay, Brazil is very poor. Most Latin American countries are kind of a particular case, where the poor people in Brazil are as poor as poor people in India, but the rich people are as rich as people in the US. So it's a very diverse kind of spectrum of inequalities within and across countries. Okay, this is a graph from my own work, and you can just see this is the distribution in any country. The bottom 40% of the population, the middle 50%, and the top 10% divided into two parts. We can see that the top 5%, which is the green part in either graph, is very, very large, their share of total income of the country. And the bottom 40% share of total income is very small, which is the blue part. Okay, so this is the whole, this is 116 countries compared. You can see that there is a specific pattern. You know, every country has a lot of income of their total income in the top 5% compared to the rest of the population. Okay, we could say this is all very nice, but why does it actually matter? Maybe it's not really a problem. There's two sets of arguments as to why it would matter, and one is an ethical set of arguments, such as the duty of justice from political philosophy, the cosmopolitan position that we equally value every human being just for being a human being, or that we feel, as in the duty of justice argument, that we feel the need to help people that are in our groups, being family, nationality, whatever. And while these arguments are quite powerful, but some of us might not have any ethics, so there's a second set of arguments, and that's of course the more important ones, because that's the economic ones, and or the instrumental arguments. And the first one is the one to the very, well, your left, is the argument of poverty. And poverty, to a large degree, is, well, it's very intrinsically related with inequality. It's not the same. It doesn't have the same origins necessarily, and it doesn't have the same consequences, or you don't need the same policies to fight it. This is very important, because people for a long time have thought that, or have argued, that inequality is only important because it creates poverty. And that's not true. It also has other factors that are very specifically related to inequality. You can see some of them there. The reason why it's so, or why it's so problematic to have poverty in an unequal society is because inequality exacerbates poverty. So, for example, through rises in through housing crisis or rises of crime, obesity epidemics, unsustainable living costs, etc. Poverty is kind of self-perpetuated in an unequal society, which is an exclusive society by definition. So inequality creates social and economic exclusion, which imperils poverty reduction in general, and it creates social cohesion and governability issues. So these might lead to further increases in crime and other forms of social and political conflict, and we can imagine that these then create insecurity and distrust among economic agents, which jeopardize economic growth, which is of course very important for us, but also social development. So that is kind of the circle that makes poverty level self-sustaining or self-perpetuating in an unequal society. Okay, the other very important part is the second picture, which is migration, and that is specifically related to high inequality. Because when you have large income gaps between countries, and you have knowledge about these income gaps, then it's very rational response by agents to move from low income to high income regions or countries. So this is something that's specifically related to inequality, mass migration, and that's very important to keep in mind. So basically, as long as we sustain very unequal distribution of incomes or wealth or access to goods in the world, we will have migrational tendencies that are probably large scale. Third one, just to go over them fairly quickly, is political instability. So in high inequality communities, individuals or across individuals, these contexts are associated with political instability. And you have, this is a case, that is a picture of a case from Mexico, where you can look up very, very large political instability at this moment. You also have spillover effects of this political instability towards any other region, which is obviously an issue, and you have high violence levels that are very closely related to inequality. And I mean, I'm going through these very fast, so if you want to know anything about that further, we can talk about it, but it's just very important factors that are highly, highly correlated with inequality if you look at empirical numbers. And finally, inequality is a, okay, so this is the final picture of social cohesion with the fish, exclusion was no better picture, but there's also a case for inequality as a causal factor for crisis, for example. And Galbraith has a lot of work on that, financial instability and inequality. Health issues, any number of other arguments can be linked to inequality to some degree. So whichever line of argumentation we want to follow of these, we see that eventually, or through some of these channels, we are all affected by inequality. And that's a very important point. So there's something for everybody. Maybe we care about poverty or crime or security, but clearly it does affect everybody, and it affects everybody negatively. Yeah? So this is very important. Okay, if we know that it matters and it's fairly high, why have we had these high levels and why have we sustained them? And that brings us to the myth about inequality that are upheld by neoclassical economics. And the first one is the famous trickle-down effect. And you probably have all heard about that. how did that come about? So the idea that there is a trickle-down effect and that inequality is useful for society is actually quite new. Seems very natural to us now, but it's came about kind of around 54 with Kuznets' idea of the inverted U-shaped curve. Have you all heard about that? So you know what it is? Yeah, okay, it says that, just to be sure that we're all on the same level. When countries develop, their inequality will rise, and then eventually it will fall, magically and naturally. Okay. So that argument was really, really useful in times of, well, when he stated it, because it was at the height of the Cold War, the starting of the Cold War, and it allowed for a very good argument for why capitalist societies are actually not lagging behind socialist economies in terms of income distribution. So it was very, very powerful, and it was a very important argument. And actually, it was a correct argument, considering the data that Kuznets had. And that's very interesting, because, I mean, the idea is not stupid, and if you look at the data, it makes perfect sense. So Kuznets looked at the data from when he had income tax data, which was roughly in the beginning of the 20th century, and you can see, he looked at the data from before even. So he could see this kind of shape, okay? The red line here, that's what he saw. Yeah, and then you can see, okay, this is kind of like an inverted U, and this is the US case, but it looks, and the UK case, and it looks a little bit similar in some other countries, European countries. And that is because something very specific happened at that time. So, looking from the data makes perfect sense to argue what he said. So the data was not the problem, the conclusion that he draw was the problem. The conclusion that he draw says that this has to be like that everywhere and all the time, okay? And this is not the case if you then amplify the frame and look at the picture that Piketty looks at now, where you can see that actually it might follow a kind of U-curve. Yeah? So now inequality is rising again. And this is also the same for a number of other countries. So if you look at longer time frames, you can see that maybe it's still limited to look at this only, even though we have this lying inverted S shape, or whatever you want to call it, a curve. It might very well be that this is actually a cyclical trend, okay? And this is something that Milanovic has discussed in a conference in September, I think. Where it was argued that potentially, we don't really know what happened before because we don't have good data for it, but it's quite possible that there is some kind of a wave dynamic. We don't really know that. But certainly it's not that everywhere and all the time there has to be an inverted U-shape in inequality. Okay, so we can look at what actually happened. What actually happened is that if you look from the 1950s to 2012 roughly, you have the blue bars being the income growth of the bottom 40, or bottom 90%, sorry, and the red bars being the income growth of the top 10%, and we can see that here, during this time, we have an equalizing society, and here, it's unequalizing, which is exactly what we saw in the graph before, right? And if we want to make it more concrete, this is from my own work, you have the 1% in the number 25 countries around 1990, the blue bar, and around 2010, the red bar, and you can see that in most countries, just the top 1% of income holders grows vastly. Okay. I have another number here for you if you want to relate it to the UK. So between 1908 and 2011, for example, the pay of a chief executive at the London Stock Exchange rose by around 500%. Yeah, and the same time, workers pay rate rose just 20%. And this is a ratio going from 45 to 1 in 98 to 185 to 1 in 2011. Yeah, so it's quite a big difference. In the US it's obviously very similar, maybe a little more extreme. But anyways, you get the point. Well, we have another example. So this is over the time from 88 to 2008. This is income growth of just the top 1%, and this is obviously from the lower income groups. Okay, so this Milanovic graph, he has very good data on that. We can see that there is a very strong unequalizing tendency, you know, instead of this trickle-down effect. this is essentially showing the same. Just to show you that whatever data we use, we all find these kind of dynamics. Okay, but maybe we need this initial inequality, and maybe that is because it's good for growth, which is what we're taught. That's the second myth. Inequality is necessary for growth. And that argument comes essentially from a statement by Okun in 75, where it is argued that a more equal society comes at the cost of economic growth. And this idea of trade-off between growth and inequality was more growth and equality, rather said, was maintained for a very long time by mainstream economics. And that also relates to Friedman's later statements about how inequality, greater inequality, would spur people to work harder and to be more productive. And we'll look at that in a second. So essentially, a bigger state that would redistribute would create distortions in the market, and that would be bad for growth. Okay, so that's how the argument goes. However, if you look at it empirically, that's not exactly true. And we can see on the left that the red line being the share of top income and the blue line being the growth rate, that these are at some points related and at some points contrary. Yeah? And then we have data from institutions such as the IMF, which is not exactly the most progressive of institutions historically speaking. Even they argue now that actually growth is negatively related to inequality. Yeah? So this is very, very important to look at. Other institutions like the World Bank and OECD, and I mean, I don't even have to mention Stiglitz or more progressive institutions like the UN Economic Commissions, they have been arguing this for quite a long time, but now it's also quite routinely argued for by OECD or World Bank or, well, IMF institutions, that in fact there is a negative correlation between growth and inequality, yeah? Especially with initial equality actually enhancing growth. So this is something becoming quite common to argue now. Well, so if initial inequality is not good for growth, and at the same time growth will not automatically lead to more equality, is it then not still true that inequality relates to our differential efforts, which is the other argument, right? So that's because we work a lot harder, so we get a higher income, this kind of argument. Well, we've just seen the graph with the US top income 1% increasing a lot and the rest of all incomes not increasing very much. So it seems quite unlikely that they're so much more productive, but we could assume for a second that they might be. So just to be sure that this is the top 1%, but if you look at the riches, 0.1% in the US, so that's the 1,000s of people in general, and they make more than 1.5 million a year, okay? So we're not talking about some middle class, something, this is like fairly rich people. They have garnered roughly 30% of total household income growth, the top 0.1%, okay? From 77 to 2007. And if you compare that with the poorest 90%, so basically the rest of the population, except those almost 10% at the top, they have seen their income grow by less than 0.5% a year. And this is a very, very big difference. Are they, these people at the very top, are they really so much more productive? Well, you can think about an example to justify this kind of argument. If we think about, for example, Liliane Bettencourt, you know her? She's the hair of L'Oréal. She basically hasn't had to work for a day in her entire life. And her fortune grew exactly at the same speed as Bill Gates. And we could argue Bill Gates is an entrepreneur that is maybe very productive and he deserves this high rate, but incidentally, Bill Gates' income grew at the same speed when he stopped working. So it's not so clear where this relationship, how this works out. You know, it's just a couple of numbers that we have to keep in the back of our head. Yeah, we've also just seen that the Milanovic graph. Sorry, here. That there is very big income differences for the rich in different countries, right? So what he argues is that there is essentially a location premium So poor people, or people being born in poor countries, have to pay location rent, while people born in rich countries actually get a benefit from that. So what he says is that of total income, you can see here, so this is a change of the way that inequality is built up in a specific country. While before it used to be very different within a country, and location didn't play a big role, I say before because it's more than 150 years ago, but now, kind of now, location plays a very large role. That means that the country in which you're born is essential for determining your income. Yeah, so he argues this kind of show me your passport and I tell you how much you earn argument. Essentially, he says that 80% is determined, of your income level is determined by the country that you live in. So that means that there's 20% left to, you can divide that depending on what you believe, to your gender, age, race, luck, and your hard work and effort. Whatever you believe in of those. Okay, so if the managers here with CEO pay increasing by 300% and, well, production worker pay by increasing by 4% a year, very, very strong difference. Is that to reflect market values, as we're told, which is the fourth myth? Salaries reflect, at least at the top, the market value. That argument is a bit polemic, we might say, because usually we like to believe that we're all quite important and effective. But nevertheless, it says that we need to have these high levels for CEOs because, or for specific groups in society, because they reflect how we value this job that he's doing, and it also helps to attract the best brains and the best capacities that we need. Maybe then, actually, bankers would have needed a negative salary in the last couple of years after the crisis. However, they haven't. They actually earned a lot more than before. I don't have data on this now. Please, if you have some, pass it on to me. I'd like to see it myself. But this is showing, because there's a very common argument saying, well, productivity is not really increasing, so we can increase the pay. And this is showing what actually happens, okay? This is in the world. You can see here, this is the increase in productivity, and this is the increase in pay. From 1999 to 2011. And here this is essentially showing the same. Your productivity is a green line, and average income increases according to the blue line, while the income of the top 1% increases according to the red line. Just so we keep in mind, this is, it's quite unlikely that this is really reflecting market value. Well, be it as it may, people might have these salaries, but we don't really want them to drop a lot, because most people believe that maybe one day we can be in this line instead of that one. So maybe we just let them be for the time being, and eventually we'll overhaul Bill Gates and make it ourselves, so let's have them have a high salary. Essentially, the argument there is that inequality is good for social mobility. Quite straightforward to debunk that myth, because this famous Great Gatsby curve, which is very nice. It says essentially that if you want to live the American dream, you have to move to Denmark, because Denmark is a country with very low income inequality and fairly high social mobility, while these countries are the more unequal ones with very low social mobility. So you can see that there is a fairly strong correlation between social mobility and high inequality. So then how, if we agree that there is a problem with inequality, how do we go about changing it? Because maybe there is a point in changing it. So the main argument from mainstream economics is that we just have to increase education and then the problem will basically resolve itself. This is not final information. I mean, we can discuss about this a lot. There is a lot of debate right now about the human capital accumulation theorem. There are some arguments in favor and some against. But essentially, if we just have this very simplistic argument that increasing education will help us get rid of inequality, we can see that this is very straightforwardly not true. Because education since the 70s has increased dramatically. both in primary, secondary, and in tertiary education. And if you recall the small graph from before, then that's kind of at the same time here, the 70s, when income inequality increased a lot as well, globally. So it cannot just be such a straightforward correlation. Also, if you look, for example, at Latin America, which has very high inequality, a lot higher than Northern Africa, for example, and incidentally, it also has very high secondary school enrollment figures, much higher than Northern Africa. So it's quite difficult to explain that with human capital development. Accumulation, sorry. Likewise, we could argue that maybe well-educated people in South Africa are very rich in human capital endowments, but we might have to question whether they are so much richer in human capital endowments than well-educated people in, say, Denmark. They might. I mean, we have to check that empirically. Surely, bless you, surely not multiple times richer in human capital. Okay. So I'm happy to discuss about this. It's not as straightforward, but this gives you some kind of initial idea that education by itself is not the solution to this problem. So what is left for us to say is that, well, it doesn't look very good, but fortunately, this is not really our problem, because this is what happens in Latin America and to some degree in Southern Africa and maybe some other countries, but it's not really such a big deal for us. Maybe to the US now becomes a little more unequal, and China as well, but in Europe, we're not really concerned by this. That's the seventh myth, and that's unfortunately not true either. So this is from my own work as well, and it compares the dark blue line is the top 1% holding, or the income that the top 1% holds. Red lines is the top 5%, and the light blue line is the top 10%. We can see that in countries such as Belgium, for example, it's one of the most unequal countries if you look at it from the top 1% earnings in the whole sample, which is quite curious. I mean, obviously the top ones is Latin American ones, okay, we can forget that, but Belgium is here, and interestingly, the Scandinavian countries, Norway is here, Denmark is one of those, Denmark is this one, it's quite high as well. It's the countries that we usually associate with a very high level of equality. Yeah, but if you look at just the top 1%, they still have a very large share of the income, of total income. And either way, if we look at the top 10%, there's no country, well, except for Slovenia, which is kind of the case by itself, it's a little bit less than 20%, but there's no other country where the top 10% own less than 20% of income share. That's a lot. It's a lot. Yeah? So it's a problem that, unfortunately, again, concerns all of us. So just before we conclude, we can think very briefly about a solution. I don't know whether you can observe this is tax rates and inequality development, and you might be able to see that there's this kind of mirroring image. Yeah, when inequality goes down, the tax rate goes up, and the other way around, when the tax rates go down, inequality goes up. So there might be some correlation there. Indeed, there is. So this is lots of bars. I'm sorry, it's a bit confusing, but essentially both of these show the same. Just that this graph also includes Latin American countries besides the OECD. But essentially what this one shows, or this one as well, is that if you have inequality from market outcomes, so from whatever people pay you or whatever you earn or own, you look at the blue bars, yeah? Inequality level is fairly high. And then something happens, fiscal policy is happening, government does something, and you get the red bars, so inequality is a lot lower. And essentially the green bar just shows the difference between inequality at market rates and after government intervention. And you can see that some countries are a lot more effective. Belgium, interesting. So that's why they're not so unequal, even though they have this very high concentration at the top. In our understanding, Finland, Germany, these are the countries that are more effective with redistribution, and then we have the US and the UK on the other extreme, and Switzerland, actually. This graph, as I say, shows exactly the same. The yellow bars are the changes in inequality after government intervention, and red is before tax and transfers, blue is distribution after tax and transfers. And we can see that there's a very, very large difference between what OECD countries manage to do in, or how they manage to decrease inequality, and what happens, for example, in Latin American countries. And my own country, Mexico, is one of the lowest ones. Actually, if you consider other numbers, it's even negative what happens after tax and transfers, because they actually regressively distribute the taxes that they collect. But it gives you some kind of an idea that this is one of the possible answers to deal with inequality, have effective fiscal policies. Maybe we can stop here and we can discuss what kind of other options there is, or whatever else you want to discuss related to this, and also I can show you some other numbers if you feel like it. Any questions? Go.
In the during all the lecture, there's a constant idea. The implicit idea is when you mentioned the 1%, the 2%, implicitly we are thinking that they are always the same person, like walking around the same. But what would happen, most likely it's not what happened in reality, but what would happen if they are always switching?
That's the idea of social mobility.
Exactly,
right?
That's where I'm going. And so it's not enough just to show the 1%, 2%, because we don't know the interior movements. So for example, an example of that is the new rich people. How many of the richest people in the world are all traditionally rich? Mm-hmm. But also, yeah, in the example, in the other myth, in the one of education, this I remember clearly, this study in Mexico, Chile, and Colombia. And the idea of this study was about education, by the way, and social mobility. And in descending order, first Chile, then Mexico, then Colombia, it was clearly how education improved that mobility among quintiles. So, I mean, that's like trying to work a little bit with the seven myths. Mm-hmm. So maybe it's not that it increased the wages immediately or things like that, but it gives more merit to the mobility.
That's a very important observation. I completely agree that we don't know whether it's the same people in the top percent, and that's why this graph is very important and why it has caused a lot of uproar in the inequality researching community, because it shows clearly that where there is high inequality, there is very little social mobility. So that means that essentially you don't have this turnover, it is the same people. And that's what social mobility will tell you.
But then how do you measure it? Because here.
Well, this is intergenerational earning elasticity, and you can use, I'm not an expert in social mobility, but there's other numbers.
The household surveys in each country, and how they're normalized. So this is really ambiguous because it's not a standard way of measuring it, because it depends on this country. How they report the data of the household surveys. And indeed, one of the most amazing results, indeed I write there, I think it's for Mexico, Torche. Flores Torche, she do a lot of that, studying how to compare fairly social mobility. And that's the issue, the aggregate is so bad, like we've been so aggregate, we cannot really measure how is the real social mobility. So to give you an example, maybe some earnings here are direct wages, while other are household earnings about rents, and it will distort all the picture.
Obviously, but I don't think, I completely agree, and there is a lot of issue with numbers, and I work with these numbers very closely, and I know that it really depends on how you define things and what you want to look for, and how other people collect these numbers. That's completely clear. I doubt that it would completely inverse the picture if you accounted for this, but it's a good point. Yes, absolutely. About the education issue, there is a lot of research on that education actually improves inequality, and it probably does. It's not 100% clear. There is pro and con findings. What is true is that very often it's actually the other way around. So when there is inequality, when people have a lot of money, they can afford better education. So it's not, the causal relationship between the two is not as straightforward as it might seem. The other thing is that people, as I say, in a very unequal country at the very top are probably as well educated as people in a less unequal country at the very top. And yet they get so much, such a larger part of total income from the country. So it's very difficult to reconcile that with the idea that just by education this will improve everything. It's definitely, education has an intrinsic value. It's important to educate people for their personal development, also for social development, and there is nothing wrong with education. That's why it's a very cheap answer, kind of. You know, it's politically cheap because nobody's against education or against increasing education, and it's very important. But that's the caution that we have to keep in mind. It doesn't necessarily and directly lead to improvement in income distribution.